Big round of applause for Simon Brown, please.
Thank you very much. I'm not entirely sure how to follow all of that, actually, including the gun thing. I need one of those. Can I get one next? Yes, superb. So, I'm not going to talk about microservices. And when I saw the first software circus, it seemed to be very much about programmable infrastructure and Docker and containers and all that cool stuff. And I'm not going to talk about any of that. Actually, I am going to talk about microservices. Because I see lots of people jumping on the microservices thing for the wrong reason. And it strikes me that we've kind of lost the ability to do software design. And I think that's going to end in a lot of tears. And if people adopt microservices for the wrong reason, we're just going to end up building distributed big balls of mud. And that's really what I want to talk about today. We see a lot of interesting kind of flip-flops in the industry, don't we? We flip-flop between extremes. Look back 10, 15 years, it was all big upfront design. And now with the whole Agile thing, we've gone to no upfront design at all. The Agile Software Development Manifesto says working software, we value working software over comprehensive documentation. And we flip-flop from comprehensive documentation to no documentation. Who's on Twitter here? Right, so you must have seen the no estimates hashtag, which does not mean no estimates. But again, we flip-flopped. The no projects hashtag, again, same sort of thing. And now it's all monoliths versus microservices. And of course, we're pitching these things as extremes. You're either building monoliths or you're building microservices because you're cool. And there's nothing in between. And that's the thing that I want to talk about today. Because the assumption here is that monoliths are evil. Monoliths are big, horrible balls of mud. So that's going to set the scene. Who on earth am I? So I'm Simon and I live in Jersey in the Channel Islands. Can you see Jersey on here?
No,
it's way too small. If this was one of those big iPad Pros, the new ones, and it was interactive, we could pinch to zoom in, gets a bit bigger, still a bit small. If we pinch to zoom in one more time, we get to see Jersey, there it is. It's a small island, just off the coast of France, 15 kilometers by 8, population 100,000 people. Why on earth do I live there? It's a nice place. Who said taxes? Why does this always happen when I come on stage? We have taxes. They're just not as much as the rest of you. But houses are expensive. So it's a nice place to live. I was actually born there, but I spent most of my career working in London for consulting companies. And I moved back to Jersey in 2008. And over the past few years, I've been kind of gesturing around the world and really helping software teams understand what software architecture is all about. And really my whole picture is that architecture needs to be much more accessible to us as software developers. There are lots and lots of architecture books out there. Who's read them? It's like three people. That's sort of the problem, isn't it? There are lots of books out there. They've been around for a number of years. The authors are super smart people, but they tend to approach architecture from a very academic or research perspective. And when I was moving into my first architecture role, I didn't really understand how those books mapped to my day-to-day job. So how do I solve this problem? I just wrote some books, some different books. The one on the right we're going to talk about a little bit is called The Art of Visualizing Software Architecture. If you're ever stuck about how to draw software architecture diagrams, go download that one for free. A quick product plug, I'm also a SaaS. So I've created a software as a service called Structurizer. It's a way to create web-based software architecture diagrams. If you want a catchy acronym, SADAS. Software architecture diagrams as a service. And that's what sums me up as well, I guess. Because ultimately, what I'm interested in here is communication and also design thinking. So quick show of hands, who's the software developer here? Is that most of you? Excellent. So imagine you join a new team next week and you inherit a big code base, like a million lines of Java code or C# code or something. And somebody asks you to draw some pictures to describe this code base you've inherited. Let's say that your million lines of code is broken up into 100,000 classes or something. Would you draw a diagram showing 100,000 boxes? No, that's absolutely ludicrous because it's just too much detail. So what we do is we use abstraction. An abstraction is a technique we use to clump or group things together. Of course, we don't really call them things. We call them components or modules or services or layers or things like this. And abstractions allow us to reason about a big or complex software system. So rather than drawing a picture with 100,000 small boxes, we draw a picture with a smaller number of bigger boxes. We immediately run into problems doing this because as an industry, we lack a standard way to think about and describe software systems. We don't have a common vocabulary. Think about the word component. How many times have you heard the word component used to mean different things? For some people, a component is, you know, a web application is a component of the entire system. And for other people, a component is something running inside that web application. So we tend to use the same word for different meanings, for different levels of abstraction. All of that stuff aside, if we can fix that problem, these abstractions that we dream up when we talk about architecture, do they match the code? Do they actually reflect stuff in our code base? And the answer is normally not really. I've visited a bunch of organizations over the past few years, and they have these beautiful A0 plotted architecture diagrams on the wall. Last updated 2007 or something. And those diagrams never reflect the code. These diagrams always have these nice, clean looking modules and clean dependencies. And then you open up the code base, it's just a horrible mess. And this is what George Fairbanks calls the model code gap. So this is a great book if you're interested in software architecture. And the model code gap is basically, when we're having a design or architecture discussion, we use words like module, component, service. But in the code, we don't have those same concepts. For those of you who are Java developers here, there's no component keyword in Java, is there? There's no layer keyword in C#. Instead, what we do is we use namespaces, packages, interfaces, our core programming constructs, and we glue them together to recreate these modules, services, layers, things. I was doing some research on this topic, and I found a paper from 1995 and it basically says the same thing. If you ask a developer or a software engineer to draw a diagram on a whiteboard of their system, you get a nice, clean-looking, high-level diagram. If you then reverse engineer the code to generate some diagrams, that reverse-generated diagram is super accurate, but it's totally different to what the engineer drew. Again, there's this mismatch of concepts. And part of the reason here is because although we think in terms of components and modules and services, we don't have those constructs in our languages. If you're doing Java, C#, you're probably thinking in terms of components, but you're probably writing classes and interfaces and namespaces and packages. And this takes us back to code. So how do we structure our code? Well, let's imagine we're building a really boring web application. We're going to do the layering thing. We'll have a layer for our web app controllers, a layer for our business processes and business services, and some sort of repository or data access layer. You've seen this sort of thing before? Yeah, it's just a traditional, typical kind of layered architecture. Why do we do this? Well, there are a bunch of reasons. Separation concerns, substitutability, mocking, testing, blah, blah, blah. Also, the books tell us this is a good thing. So this is a picture I stole from a Spring book. It says, if you want to build a Spring MVC app, do it like this. It's a bunch of layers. You turn the page, it tells you why. You download some sample code off the internet, you load it into your IDE, you get a layered architecture. You get a package for controllers, a package for domain things, a package for data access things. You go onto Stack Overflow, how do I organize my source code in my repo? Yeah, do it like this. Again, it's a layered architecture. We're being pointed to build these layered architectures. Same in the .NET world. Now, of course, there are some benefits of layered architectures. And normally what we do is we start out with this nice, strict layered approach in mind. So stuff in my top layer will only talk to stuff in the next layer, and so on and so forth. And we try to create these really clean structures. But the problem is, in languages like Java, if each of these red boxes representing a layer, normally we implement these things as a Java package. In order for one thing in one package to call another thing in another package, the classes need to be public. And once the classes are public, they can be called from anywhere. So we have feature set A, feature set B, feature set C. And it's all beautiful and clean. What happens when feature set C needs to access stuff in B? Oh, you choose. And it's entirely up to you. And if left unchecked, this is how your nice layered architecture turns into that horrible big ball of mud. It's funny, I run software architecture and sketching workshops, and I've asked teams to draw me a diagram of their system. And they draw me a nice, neat, layered diagram. And I ask them, is that really what you think you have? Yes. Show me the code. And when we look at the code, it's like that. You might think, well, we're not doing layers anymore. We're doing clean architectures and hexagonal architectures and onion architectures. Well, guess what? These are just layers as well. They're just drawn differently. It doesn't solve the problem. A layer is evil. I think that's a bit of a harsh statement. Is layering a cargo cult? Are we just doing layers because we think we should? Do we really understand what the layers are giving us? Are we thinking about these things consciously? A layer is actually important. Right, if we take our code base, are layers the primary way we should structure our software system? Or should we, in fact, be structuring it in a different way, and layers are just some implementation detail of those things? For those of you familiar with Uncle Bob Martin, he has this blog post called Screaming Architecture. And he basically says, if you look at most enterprise apps, they're all completely identical. You open up the directory with the code in, and you get a domain package, and a controller package, and a web package, and a repository package, and all apps are the same. And he says, maybe that's bad. If you look at a set of blueprints for a library, the blueprints scream, this is a library. If you look at the blueprints for a house, it screams, this is a house. And maybe we need to apply that same concept to our code base, so that something at the top level tells us something about what we're building. Martin Fowler back in the summer said the same sort of thing. He said, this layering thing is great. You know, controllers and business logic and data logic, It's a very, very simple way to get started with most projects. But once you get any sort of scale, you have to start modularizing inside your layers, otherwise you just get a layer with everything in it. And that's complex. And he says, well, one of the other things you could do is not slice horizontally, but slice vertically. And often we call this package by feature. So what we do is we bundle up all of the things related to feature set A in their own package, in their own layer, essentially. Same with B, C, and so on. Does this solve the problem of messy code bases? Not really. It's just a different way to structure your code. The benefit of this is from the top level, you get to see what your major feature sets are, or maybe you're organizing your layers around aggregate or bounded context or something. So all of that aside, and we will come back to this in a second, however you think about your software systems, the diagrams you draw, the abstractions you use, those should reflect stuff in the code. So we have a bunch of problems to solve here in the industry. How do I do this? How do I think about software systems? Well, for me, very simply, a software system is made up of a bunch of containers. Now, I don't mean Docker containers, I mean software containers. And essentially for me, a software container is something that executes code or hosts data. In real world terms, this is anything like a mobile app or a web app or a database or a batch process or a standalone application. There's actually quite a nice mapping between a container in my view and a Docker container. Right? These are individually deployable things. If we lift the lid on my containers, they're very simply made up of components. So I'm going to use the word component to mean something running inside an application, inside a container. It's just a bunch of related stuff with a nice clean interface on top. And because I mostly deal with Java systems, my components are made up of classes. And that's it. It's a really simple hierarchical structure to describe the static structure of my software systems. This works for OO languages. If you're using JavaScript, maybe it's not components and classes. Maybe it's modules and objects. If you're using functional programming languages, maybe it's modules and functions. So you might have to take this idea and tweak it to match the tech that you're using. But this is about creating some sort of simple hierarchy to describe your software. When I did my brief intro to where I live, and I did the Can You See Jersey, you went, no, it's too small. The reason I was doing that is because I wanted to plant the seed about maps. When I'm trying to describe a software system, especially when I'm trying to diagram a software system, I want to create a set of maps, and the maps essentially help me navigate that code base. If you open up your smartphone now and do a search for Jersey on Google Maps, for example, it will take you to that bottom left picture. Google Maps will zoom into Jersey and fill the screen with it. And this is fantastic if you want to know what's inside Jersey and what the place names are. If you've never heard of it, it's totally useless. So the first thing you have to do is zoom out a few notches to get back to some context, the map of Europe in this case. The software diagram's the same. Sometimes, as a developer, I want a zoomed in view of the world, components. And at other times, depending on who I'm speaking to, I might want to zoom out a couple of notches. So how do I actually do this? Well, the first thing I'll draw is a context diagram. So this is a very top-level diagram to describe my software system. This is an example from a system I built. It's a simple content aggregator for the local tech industry in Jersey. It's called techtribes.je. Basically just lists local people, businesses, blog posts on the site. Various types of users at the top, and various types of system dependencies at the bottom. That's it. It's just a diagram to set the scene. This is Tech Tribes. This is how it fits into the rest of the world. If it was truly interactive, we could do the pinch to zoom in movement on the Tech Tribes box, and we could zoom down to containers. So this is the next level. This is level two, and this is a container diagram for the Tech Tribes system. This is showing you the high-level technical structure of my Tech Tribe system. Basically, it's made up of a web application here. That's the single point of access for the users. There's a content updater at the bottom. It's a standalone Java process. It's the thing that reaches out to Twitter, GitHub, blogs, and pulls all that data back. And the data is being stored somewhere in the middle. There's a MySQL database for storing most of the stuff, a MongoDB store on the other side for storing the tweets and the blog posts, and there's a shared file system in the middle. So again, it's just showing the high-level structure. This diagram is not showing anything about clustering or sharding or availability or zones or whatever. That's a separate deployment picture. If we were to take the content updater and pinch to zoom in, well, we get to see what's inside the content updater. In this case, it's a component diagram for the content updater. The content updater is basically everything inside this gray box here. And all of these boxes in the middle are just my components inside my content updater. There's a scheduled task, a spring scheduled task in the middle, gets kicked every 15 minutes, uses these connectors to the outside world down here, and these components up here for storing stuff in my various databases. That's it. It's a very, very nice, simple, high-level diagram. If we were to take the tweets component, so the tweet component basically allows you to store tweets into a Mongo database and pull them out again, nothing more than that. If we were to pinch to zoom into that tweet component, well, with the initial implementation, you get this. The initial implementation of my Tech Tribe system was a typical Java layered architecture. There's a bunch of web controllers in the web app and a bunch of services and a bunch of data access objects. And that's basically what this diagram is showing you. And this raises a kind of interesting question. Well, where's my component gone? On my component diagram, I had one box. And it was called Tweets Component. And now we've zoomed into the code, it's missing. The Tweet Component does not exist as a single thing. It's a bunch of interfaces and classes collaborating across a layered architecture. So I lied to you. My component diagram lied to you. It's a really, really simple example of the model code gap. My diagram, my component diagram, my architecture diagram says one thing. My code says something different. The two concepts don't quite match. How do I fix this problem? Well, I've got two options, broadly speaking. Option one is to redraw my diagram so it doesn't lie. And really what I mean by this is, instead of drawing one box for my tweets component, I should draw two boxes, one for the service bit and one for the data access bit. And that seems like a lot of work, because now I have twice as many boxes in my diagram. And that's hard, especially if you're using Visio. The other approach is just to make my code reflect my architecture, to do a refactoring. And this is something that George Fairbanks talks about in his book. He calls it an architecturally evident coding style. This is nothing more than making your code reflect your architecture, dropping hints and metadata into your code so that your code reflects your architectural ideas and intent. And in the real world, there are a bunch of really, really simple ways to do this. Naming conventions. If I have a tweet component on my diagram, I should have something in the code called component. Maybe it's done through namespacing and packaging. Maybe I create a namespace or package boundary around a single component. It could be machine readable metadata, annotations or attributes. Now, marking something as being a component, for example. Maven modules, OSGI modules, you know, the module frameworks is another example of an architecture we have in a coding style. Perhaps a module in the code represents a component on a diagram. Java 9 is getting module support, of course. JavaScript is just a pain in the ass, right? It's just too easy to create messy JavaScript. Thankfully, ECMAScript 6 is getting module support, so hopefully we'll see some cleanup in that area. And microservices. Actually, microservices is a really, really good example of an architecturally evident coding style. For those of you who are doing microservices architecture here, if we were to drag you up the front and get you to draw a picture of your microservices architecture, I'm pretty sure your picture would be a bunch of boxes, one per service. And I'm pretty sure we could find each of those services in the code really easily. So there's a nice clean mapping between how we think about our architecture and what the code looks like. But I'm not talking about microservices, am I? I'm talking about monoliths. So how do we make this work in a monolith? Well, something you can do is use the namespacing or packaging thing. You know, put some module boundaries around your code. And when I'm building Java systems, I use what I call package by component. And what I'm essentially trying to do is create a package boundary around a component. This is basically a dirty, nasty workaround until we get proper modules in Java, but actually it works really well. And the actual refactoring I've come up with is very, very simply like this. So we've gone from the thing on the left to the thing on the right. My tweet service interface at the top is now called tweet component. So again, I'm trying to match the names up here. My default tweet service, I'm using Spring, can you tell, is horribly named. So what I've done is I've renamed it tweet component impl, which is also horribly named. But I've made it package protected. So in Java, this means you can't see it from the outside world. It's just an implementation detail. My tweet DAO I've deleted, and I've basically hardwired my MongoDB tweet DAO into my tweet component impl class, and also made that package protected. It's a really, really simple refactoring. If anybody building code for this system wants access to my list of tweets out of the database, they're now forced to go through that one interface. They can't skip around and call the data access object directly. This is not a silver bullet. This diagram often freaks people out because they say, well, I like layered architectures and you don't have a layered architecture anymore. And the answer is, actually I do. I still have a layered architecture, but my layered architecture is inside my components. So I'm treating this box, this package, as a component, and it has layers inside it. Testing is a little tricky. If we look at the traditional approach to unit testing, often what we do, if we want to unit test this thing in isolation, because we have this dependency on an interface, we plug in a mock implementation of the database, and we have nice, fast-running unit tests. I've made that a little bit trickier on the right-hand side. And my simple answer is I don't do unit testing. I'm not going to say any more about that topic. If you want to talk about testing, come grab me in a coffee break. I promise you I do test that. In terms of the code, what does this code actually look like? This is it. So I've got a bunch of packages, one per component down here. And all of my tweet component related things are inside a single package. I've also added this sneaky little annotation up here. This is my own custom annotation. It's signaling that this thing is somehow important, somehow structurally important. My structurizer SAS tool, there's an open source library called structurizer for Java. It understands these annotations and this way of working. And actually what you can do once you have some metadata or some rules in your code base is you can auto-generate a component diagram really easily. So now when we do go back to that components diagram, and we have our tweet component in the top right corner, if we pinch to zoom in, hooray! Now we have a nice clean mapping between our abstraction, our component, and actually what the code looks like. And that's what I'm trying to get to here. I'm trying to get to a point where we're thinking once again about modularity as a thing we do. Modularity is a principle. Whether you do it like this or by some other technique, it doesn't really matter. The thing I'm ultimately trying to do here is stop a big ball of mud being created. Who's a fan of the microservices architectural style? It's not as many as I thought, actually. The thing I like about microservices is that every microservice is supposed to be small and do one thing, and do one thing well. Why don't we take that same approach into our monolithic code bases? Currently, we have this weird thing in the industry where our monolithic code bases are made up of layers, or onions, or whatever you want to call them, and we have microservices as something different. Whenever I've spoken to people who are doing microservices, they're not doing the layers thing inside their microservices because the microservices are so small. But the nice thing about microservices is you've got some nice module boundaries, a nice clean interface, and you can substitute and swap out your microservices implementation at any time you want to. And that's a really nice design principle. And what I want to do is I want to take that and apply it to my monolith to make a nice, clean, structured, modern monolith. Like with the microservices world, you get to make some choices. Choices like, well, where do my domain classes go? So if I'm chopping up my monolithic code base into a bunch of nice, neat modules or components, where do my domain classes go? Especially if they're shared between components. And you have some choices. You can put the domain classes next to or inside the components, or you can put them outside in a big bag of domain stuff. I tend to do the latter. Both are options, both with trade-offs. Shared code is always another one. So what happens if my components share some code? Oh, that's horrible. Again, you've got a bunch of options. You either just share code, you create a utilities library, and you share the code in your monolith, that's fine. You do the copy-paste thing. That's what we tend to do in a microservices-style environment. So we break all dependencies between our microservices. Again, you choose. It's entirely up to you. You have options. Data. One of the things we normally do within our monoliths is we couple all of our data together behind the scenes. And actually, this is what makes a lot of monoliths hard to break up into microservices. And again, you get to make some choices. If you go down the modular monolith approach, do you couple your data at the data layer? So for example, do you have foreign keys between tables and have this additional level of coupling that you need to break in the future? Or do you treat every component as its own thing in a database? You can have all of the tables in the same database but not have that coupling at the database level. Again, you get to make some choices. There are all trade-offs. And that's exactly the point of all this. These are design decisions. They need to be consciously made and not just cargo culted because, hey, that's what we do, or that's what we did last time. If you don't have a reason for what you're doing, stop, think, and talk. What is the whole point of this? It's all about maintainability of systems. I've been in the software industry 20 years now. I've seen a lot of horrible systems. Systems that are really hard to maintain. I've also seen some really easy to maintain systems. The ones that are horrible to maintain are normally those horrible big balls of mud, where everything is tightly coupled and you just can't carve stuff out neatly. And the maintainability is normally inversely proportional to these types of things. The number of public classes you have, the number of dependencies you have between things, and maybe the number of microservices. You know, companies like Netflix get this right because they're big and they're smart and they have lots of money to do this. For us mere mortals, this becomes slightly trickier. It's also about agility. We're always talking about lean startups and MVPs and moving fast. If we want agility, if we want to be able to pivot quickly, we need a software system that enables change. And actually, agility is a key driver here. It's a non-functional requirement. It's a quality attribute. I'm sure you're familiar with performance and security and scaling and availability as quality attributes, as non-functional requirements. Next time you're building something from scratch, throw agility in as well. How much agility do you think you need from your software? Why would you want to ask that question? Well, that really drives the style of architecture you should perhaps build. Monoliths on the left, they're quick to build. They're easy to design. We've been doing this for decades. We have fantastic refactoring support in our tooling for, you know, refactoring inside a monolithic code base. Deployment's easy, scaling's easy. The downside of a monolithic code base is basically, well, if you don't look after it, it turns into a mess. And if you don't apply a certain amount of discipline. And also, if you want to make a one-line code change in your monolith, you have to redeploy the whole thing. It's trade-offs. Some fantastic stories, Etsy, Facebook, you know, people who are building big monolithic systems and iterating very, very quickly. On the other side, service-oriented architectures, service-based architectures, microservices. These things get you lots of agility, don't they? Instead of deploying one thing, you're breaking your system up into lots of smaller things. The smaller things somehow collaborate. The smaller things, the services can be written in any language. They can be deployed separately, scaled separately. It's a fantastically agile style of architecture. But there are trade-offs. It's a much more complex style of architecture. In a naive microservices approach, all you're doing is you're shifting the dependencies outside of your monolithic code base into the network. And that's why I jokingly call microservices architectures a distributed big ball of mud. Because that's what happens if you start synchronously tying your microservices together. You're not really changing the architecture, you're just sticking a network in the way. But there are lots of other benefits. And of course, it's not extremes. It's not monoliths that are horrible versus microservices which are cool. There's stuff in the middle. There's a spectrum of approaches, and that's what I want to talk to you about. I like the idea of building a modular monolith. A nice, clean, well-structured monolith. It's good old-fashioned component-based design. We identify a bunch of components, a bunch of modules, we give them a single responsibility, and we minimize the coupling and the dependencies between them. That gets us some structure, it buys us some structure, it buys us some agility. Not as much as the microservices architecture, because you still need to do a full redeploy. But it's moving you in the right direction. If I have three components and I want to take the second one out and make it a microservice, if it's well structured, I can just carve that thing out much, much easier. So it's a really nice stepping stone to a microservices architecture. And for me, you jump on a microservices architecture if the microservices architecture gives you benefits. Benefits like you need individually deployable things, you need individually upgradable or replaceable things, or you just want to use a bunch of different languages in your environment. Right, that's the real benefits that microservices architecture gives you. So you need to choose microservices because it gives you benefits, not because your monolithic code base is a mess. And I do see people writing blog posts going, hey, we have this horrible mess, and now we're moving to microservices. I'm like, oh God. Good luck with that approach. If your software system is hard to work with, you need to change it. Right? You have the full power to restructure and refactor your code base if it's hard to work with. In closing, I think you should think about how to align the software architecture view of the world with the code. You know, think about the abstractions that you use when you're describing your software to other people, and make sure you can find those things in the code. A really easy way to do this is to start thinking about that architecturally evident coding style, making sure that your code somehow reflects and matches the structures you think about. This is hard to do, though. This is really, really hard to do. So what advice can I give you right now, this morning, that you can take away and take action on? Well, for those of you who are doing C# and Java, stop making every damn class public. Right? This is a really, really easy fix. And we're pushed into doing this by our frameworks, and in fact, our tooling as well. Whenever I fire up my tooling and I do a new class, it creates it public by default. No, stop doing that. Turn that feature off. It's also muscle memory. Every time I type a class manually, I find myself typing public class. I'm like, no, I don't need that class to be public. It's muscle memory. How do I fix that problem? Well, I could chop your fingers off whenever you do it. It's a bit harsh, especially since it's Christmas. A much simpler piece of advice, every time you do this without thinking, stick a euro in a charity pot. Right, that'll work. Stop fining people when they start making stuff public when it shouldn't be. And basically, the closing comment on all of this is very simply this. If you can't build a modular monolith, don't jump on microservices. Thank you very much. So since we started early, and I finished early, and we have some time left. Questions?
Yes.
So I think this is pretty awesome. I can completely agree, but I have a question. Do you have an idea on how to foster a kind of culture inside a company that motivates this kind of thinking? How do you move from what's the name of the function to what kind of component are we creating? What level of abstraction are we thinking? Do we have any tips?
Yeah, it's a really good question. And the very simple answer is when I go and visit development teams, most of the teams are stuck in the code. And they don't really care too much about this stuff. And the very simplest way I've got teams to change their behavior is to draw some pictures. So all of this comes back to pictures at some point. And what I do with teams is I work with them to draw some pictures of their architecture and to step back slightly away from the code. And actually, once they start to see those pictures, especially at the component level, and they start to see those weird dependencies that really shouldn't be there, they almost know what to do. They almost know that they need to think about perhaps reducing the dependencies or reducing the coupling. So visualizing the problem or visualizing the current state of the system, of the code base, is a really, really good starting point. And it's something that only needs to take a couple of hours.
You mentioned about hardwiring the database dependency in your example component. Now, you said we could talk about testing after the talk, but since Uncle Bob is such a test-driven development proponent, I'm wondering, like, how do you propose that hardwiring something, which probably is better since you're not going to have as many implementations of that tweet DAO, except for the Mongo one. How do you propose that you could decouple inside your component so that you can at least test it independently?
Right, it's a really good question. I actually skipped a bunch of slides because I thought this is going to be more microservices and Docker focused than the testing side. So this is our traditional testing pyramid. When we have a bunch of fast running unit tests, we have some slower, probably broken integration tests, the things that when you come in on a Monday morning they always break, and hopefully if you're lucky you have some other level tests. What does a unit mean? Right, it's a really interesting question. What is a unit? For some people, a unit is a function or a method or a class, and for others, a unit is a unit of behavior. And of course, when we talk about integration testing, what are we integrating? Well, we're integrating units. And this whole thing makes no sense whatsoever because the definitions of the words are just very, very vague. So my approach is very simply this. Let's get the types of testing to match up with the way that we think about architecture. So to answer your question, what I do is I still have a bunch of unit tests, but I call them class-level tests because what they're doing is they're testing individual classes at one at a time. In my tweet example, what I actually do is I write some component tests. So in other words, I spin up Mongo. You know, it's very, very easy to do. This is a fast laptop. I've got Vagrant running. You can spin Mongo up, throw some data into it, and write some automated tests through the public component interface. And that's a fantastic technique because hardware is fast, it's easy to do, and you've got some nice component boundaries. That strategy works in this tweet component example because I own the entire stack. It's mine. If that tweet component went out to Twitter or sent an email or sent an asynchronous message, then I need to start structuring the code inside of my component so I can provide a mock implementation of the outside world. So what I'm really trying to do here is create a set of test strategies, and we need to thoughtfully apply these test strategies. So sometimes a class level test is best, and other times a component level test is best. And for me, it's making sure that the way we think about our system and the way we structure our system matches the way that we test our system. So that's why in the tweak component example, I don't do unit testing, I do component testing. But that's not a rule that I blindly apply, because I have other components where that's not going to work at all. Does that answer the question? That was a kind of long-winded answer.
No, I like how you work back in the fact that you need to consciously think about how you set it up.
Yeah. What I'm really trying to do here is I'm trying to write as few lines of test code as I possibly can to get the maximum coverage. If I put those words on the slide, somebody would take a photo and tweet that Simon Brown said we should only write one test across our entire system. And that's not what I'm saying. But I do want to minimize test code because it's a side thing, really. It's important, but it's really a side thing.
Do you have one more question? Yes.
I really like the matching between static, your static structure that you give. But architecture is, I think, different functions of the whole product cycle. So how do you work from like early stages to like end product or refactoring things? What are different kind of visualizing those things, facilitating change, or documenting stuff, or giving something else? So what's the process of the product cycle?
So you're asking more from a kind of documentational diagramming perspective?
Yeah, there's a reason why we diagram stuff. We need to facilitate some kind of processes or to get message done or to reflect something.
Yeah.
So how is that range differing over the whole product cycle?
Right. So I'm still a big fan of doing upfront design. I won't do big upfront design, but I will do upfront design down to component level. And actually, that's something you can do very, very quickly. So what I'll do during an upfront design exercise is I will draw some diagrams on whiteboards on pieces of paper, just to kind of set the scene so we have a single direction we can head in. What happens about 33 seconds after you start writing the first line of code, your diagrams are out of date. So once I've started writing code, really what I want is I want to automate the diagram generation process. And that's why I've put this structurizer thing together, because what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to build a set of tooling that allows me to create useful architecture diagrams that match the way that I think about architecture. So it's upfront diagrams at the start. Once you start having code, these things are continuously kept up to date. You plug it into your build process and everything stays up to date nicely. So that's my diagramming approach in a nutshell.
Okay, that's all we've got time for right now. You're going to be sticking around for the rest of the day,
I'm indeed, yeah.
Okay, so if you've got any more questions for Simon, go and find him. Now you know what he looks like. A big round of applause, please.